Welcome to today's discussion on the Federalist and Anti-Federalist Papers, sponsored by the Principles of Freedom Foundation. The purpose of this foundation is to provide a platform for discussing the ideas pertaining to freedom, just as was done in town squares, churches, and taverns during the founding era of this nation. Ideally, those who listen to or participate in this discussion will have come prepared by having read the materials to be discussed today. So participating in today's discussion, we have Tyler and Tiffany Mason, Derek. Oh my gosh, why did I just blank on your last name? Come on, help me.
Derek Harris.
There we go. Derek Harris. Juliet Bellinger, Abby Bowman, David Bishop, and myself, Brooklyn McClure. You know, it's because you didn't have, you have D-Rock on there as your name, and so it totally threw me. Okay, so we hope that you will continue to participate in the discussion of freedom even beyond this podcast by commenting on our Facebook group, YouTube channel, and most importantly, by having a dialogue with your own family and friends. So today we're discussing the Federalist Papers. We're gonna focus on Federalist 37 and also 23. So I wanted to give a little bit of a background because I realized almost all Americans have this blacked out part of our American history. Like most probably don't know a lot about our history anyway, but then there's this period that they know nothing about. And if you were to ask anybody, they usually think, oh, 1776, they'll maybe get that year. We declared independence, then we got our constitution, and the rest is history. But what they don't realize is that 1776, we declared our independence, but then our first constitution, or the first document we were governed by in these new states, was called the Articles of Confederation. That was in 1777. And then up until 1787, there was this experiment going on, and all the world was looking at us thinking, this is gonna fail. They're just watching us, waiting for us to fail, because nobody had given individuals and states that much freedom before. And to be honest, it almost did. And that's why then in 1787, really triggered by the riots caused by the farmers and Shays' Rebellion, they have this other convention that came together in May of 1787 to amend the Articles of Confederation and to see how they could fix things to add more stability. So now turning to Madison's words on what went on in this convention in Federalist number 37, what were some of the difficulties and challenges that you noticed from this reading that the founders faced, these 55 men faced, and perhaps the miracles even that came about during that convention? Did anything stand out to any of you?
Like the biggest one was how much power is too much power, and equalizing the small and the large states and the different resources was a big part of that. But it just seemed like it came down to power.
And do we perhaps have that same discussion going on in our country today? Yeah, thanks for pointing that out. Did anybody else have anything they wanted to share?
I noticed that he said, it has been too evident from their own publications that they have scanned the proposed Constitution, not only with a predisposition to censure, but with a predetermination to condemn, as the language held by others betrays an opposite predetermination or bias, which must render their opinion also of little moment in the question. So basically, there were people who were coming at it with a desire to rip it apart. I think we see that today a lot. People come from their point of view and are looking to enforce that point of view and tear apart anything that might, you know, question that point of view. And that isn't really a way to arrive at any conclusion that is good for everyone. That's not compromise. That's not, you know, working together to create something that works for everyone. It's destructive, right? And I think a lot of the conversation surrounding issues today is often that. Proving, I want to prove myself right. And that's pretty much it.
Yeah, it's not following the seven habits, you know, of seeking to understand before speaking and seeking to be understood, right?
Yes.
It does remind me of the end, though, where he says the way this miracle was able to be brought about in the end, this consensus of these 55 men, was by sacrificing private opinions and partial interests for the public good.
Yes.
And that's really challenging, especially I think about our Congress today. I'm like, could they have come to that decision?
Yeah. How do you set aside some of those things? Because no two people are going to agree on everything. That's mm-hmm. that's just not going to happen. And you have a lot more than two people dealing with matters of government. So you have to know what you're willing to, you know, where compromise can be made, what's worth holding on to tightly, and what's worth saying, okay, you know what, maybe that's close enough.
And maybe it's important that we practice that in our personal lives before we expect it to start manifesting in our public life even. Derek, did you have something?
Yeah. I think you painted a beautiful backdrop, and we have to remember that when the Declaration of Independence was signed, we were still not independent. We were still part of Great Britain. They didn't just say, oh, you guys signed a Declaration of Independence. Okay, here you go. You're independent. We had to fight a very long 9-year war because it was just a piece of paper until it was, you know, made valid by winning a war. And we had no business winning that war. We were so small and so divided in a lot of ways, united in a lot of ways. And I want to point out the greatness of George Washington in all of this, because the small states and the large states had no desire to meet together. The large states didn't mind because they had so much power, the Virginia and New York, Pennsylvania, but the smaller states were like, I'm not going to no, you know, I don't know how they would have said it, but I'm not going to no stupid convention. I'm not going to get a voice. And then they found out who was going to preside over that meeting. And they said, oh, George Washington is going to preside. Okay. I'll consider it. And of course, the moral deliberation, which is a phrase that I heard, listened to in this, in these Federalist Papers, I thought was very, very interesting. They had a moral compass to deliberate with. And so that's what we're reading when we read these Federalist Papers is, okay, here's 13 colonies that had resistance. For example, George Washington ardently despised New Englanders. He didn't like New Englanders, but had to swallow his pride, put aside petty differences. And for me, these are all working components to getting in a room full of very idealistic men, very well-read men who knew Greek and Roman history, which is probably the primary place where they drew a lot of their, took a lot of their information from. For example, and this is important because the Greek states failed because they were never united against their common foe, which was the Persians. The Athenians had a very powerful navy, but they had no army to speak of. The Spartans had an absolutely unconquerable army, but had no navy to speak of. But the Peloponnesian Wars were fought back and forth by the Greeks, or by the Spartans and the Athenians. And so there was many, many more what they called nation. They were nation states, but they were just city states. They were all cities. And there was a large number, but those are the two that were the most famous. And so the founding fathers knew how important it was to be a United States, not a divided states like the Greeks were. And so I think this is a good starting point to find out what's in their head, what's at stake, and how do we implement a federal government that's powerful enough to fight off an enemy foe and keep foreign interest out, but allow the people enough of a voice to have individual states and have the autonomy to some degree as a state. And that's why, to me, the Constitution is so beautiful.
It is a beautiful balance. And I think it's important to point out that the problems faced with the Articles of Confederation, I mean, each state had its own currency. Each state had its own militia. They had no way to raise funds for their confederacy as a whole to protect their national border, and except to ask, and they tried, said, hey, all you states, will you, out of the charity and love of your own hearts, give us some money to build up these things? Didn't happen. And they had no executive branch to enact those laws. They had, and why? Because they were so fearful of establishing another monarchy, another tyranny, that they're like, we're gonna create a government that's only confederacy, only states' rights, lots of democracy with the people, and absolutely no head of that government to enact anything. You know, they kind of swung that pendulum and it was a little too far towards democracy. And we know democracy just is the most unstable form of government, a pure democracy. You don't see any pure democracies in any nations because they immediately turn to a tyranny because it's too much chaos, it's not anarchy. So yeah, I think one of the challenges with that is, again, building in enough democracy into the constitutional republic, avoiding anarchy, but not giving so much, like Abby's talking about this power balance, that then you swing it to the tyranny, which is what the anti-federalists were afraid of, right? Did anyone else have anything else they wanted to contribute to that?
Yeah, I mean, reading these made me think about what is freedom even mean. I think in the latter part of the Roman Empire, freedom was like the freedom to have and possess things, and I think we've kind of gone more along that definition. And so what I've thought is there's a lot of freedom as he addresses. I mean, he says, Madison says, they solicit the attention of people who add to their sincere zeal for the happiness of their country. To have that happiness, desire for the happiness of a country, already shows some sense of internal freedom that is beyond oneself, or getting rid of, you know, I think lots of times our own personal freedoms are blocked by our own cravings or our fears and just punishments and rewards. And I like the way he's approaching those who are zeal for happiness of others. And I think already he's eliciting or showing that internal freedom. So
that's a good point. So you even see that it's really, yeah, cravings and fears, like you said, that would lead to personal bondage. But then we exude that out, right? So they had a fear. They were acting on a fear of having another monarchy. And out of that fear grew this Articles of Confederation, which was a good experiment. I mean, it was what it was. You can't expect someone that's that abused to go right into, okay, yeah, let's get another strong central government. It's like God in his leniency even allowed that, right? Like, okay, you know what, do a decade of experimenting with this, and it wasn't working out so well, and then this next group came together. So I think there's something definitely to practicing that in our own personal life first, overcoming our own fears and cravings, and then have it. It seems like what you were saying, David, was then it develops in you a love for the public virtue, for doing good, for the love of others and your country. Do you have something else you wanted to add?
No, certainly. I mean, I have 12 children, and you know, and all we have children here. I mean, I can't. I've had to look at myself. I have to look at myself and be honest about where do I espouse principles of freedom. And, you know, scripturally, we're all in bondage unless we rely on a divine and seek divine wisdom. And true freedom then comes from basically transcending my own personal desires. And ironically, that's where truly true joy only comes through that. So they were looking for this happiness, this something higher. They knew they sensed there was something special here, you know, and I can kind of see this in this exuberance, this desire. And I think that's really, really beautiful, the intensity. And even as we read other arguments, you see this desire for the well-being.
Yeah. So I'd like to read this quote by Madison. And then I'll open it up if anyone has anything else to say on this paper, and then we'll move to 23. But he says, "The real wonder is that so many difficulties should have been surmounted, and surmounted with an unanimity almost as unprecedented as it must have been expected. It is impossible for any man of candor to reflect on this circumstance without partaking of the astonishment. It is impossible for the man of pious reflection not to perceive in it a finger of that almighty hand, which has been so frequently and signally extended to our relief in the critical stages of the revolution." So there he does recognize that, wow, it was a miracle that these 55, call them the 55 fathers, there's a book on them, came together, were able to balance those powers, and not perfectly. And he recognizes that at the beginning of the paper, like, we are fallible men. This is not a perfect document, but it's as perfect as we could get it. And then also, again, recognizing the hand of God in it. So did anybody have anything else they wanted to add with regard to this paper before we move on to 23?
I got one thing. I think it's important to point out, too, that a lot of the delegates that arrived at the convention were under the understanding that they were just going to revise the Articles of Confederation. So there's a little bit of subterfuge going on there, because they knew, you know, these men are deliberating, how are we going to get all of these alpha males together in the same room without pulling our limbs apart? Because there was some robust discussion. It was private. So they knew that they could be themselves. They're not playing an act to a camera like our modern day politicians are, where it's all, you know, smoke and mirrors, but they could be themselves and shout and scream and yell. I don't know if that was going on, but I know it was very hot and sweaty in there because they didn't have air conditioning. But once they started to discover, because Madison was the chief architect of the Constitution, so he has, it seems, the primary vested interest in making sure this thing passes, and he had to deal with some alterations that were occurring, which he thought were failings, which later he thought, he realized, wow, like what was mentioned here, that there's a divine hand that's been guiding us and guiding men's hearts. And they're watching people move together rather than moving apart, which in a really intelligent, knowledgeable discussion like we're having, like we're trying to have, I'm trying to contribute to, the end result that can happen from that, if your hearts are inclined by our Creator, miracles can happen, and the Constitution is nothing short than a miracle. And you mentioned it's in the preamble that it's not a perfect, but in order to form a more perfect union, meaning a better than we've ever seen before, more perfect, and that with the amendment process, it allows for changes to be made when somebody sees an error that they can fix and it has a 3/4 majority, then they can move forward with that. So I wanted to point that out.
Thank you for
I'd just like to say one of the things I like that Madison did in 37 was he kind of laid out what republicanism is, which I think is kind of an important part of the discussion, especially since I feel one of the most common misconceptions when I talk to people today is not knowing what type of government we actually have. I frequently hear that word democracy thrown around, even by our leaders. Makes me crazy. I'm like, no, we're a republic, you know, a constitutional republic, you know. And but he says, I like how he says it. He says, the genius of republican liberty seems to demand on one side, not only that all power should be derived from the people, but that those entrusted with it should be kept in dependence on the people by a short duration of their appointments, and that even during this short period, the trust should be placed not in a few, but in a number of hands. Stability, on the contrary, requires that the hands in which power is lodged should continue for a length of time the same. And he goes on to talk about, you know, this short duration of time. I don't think it was ever intended for, you know, career politicians, so to speak, you know, serving for many, many decades and things. And where they did serve, there would be, you know, I think they would be serving in different areas and, like it said, dependent on the people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you for pointing that out. And like Abby opened us up with, that was a tricky mathematical balance. And I thought it was brilliant though. You know, you have the House every 2 years and you have the Senate for 6-year terms. So you have that refreshing, ideally, of new people coming in while also maintaining stability. But as we know, without that moral compass of the people and of the leaders, that all starts to shake out and to fall apart. So, hey, Derek.
Excellent point, you guys. Juliet, good, excellent. It seems to be kind of the new push for the American people, it seems to me, correct me if I'm wrong, that we are trying to get term limits. Term limits weren't a part of the Constitution until FDR's overweening power served for, died in office in his fourth term. And right after that, even a majority of his own party agreed to amend the Constitution to term limits just for the executive. Now that hasn't happened for the other branches. It should. Of course, with the Supreme Court, it's good behavior. What does that mean? I don't know. But I like that pointed it out, and I liked it when I heard it in the Federalist Papers that it's not intended. I can't remember how it's worded, but it's not intended for you to serve your entire life as a representative because of what it does. And I'm going to post it in the comments later when I'm going to look it up. But Calvin Coolidge gave an amazing quote why he did not run for a second term, because of what happens to you when everybody thinks that you're great because you're president, and you start to think that you're better than you are because everybody's kind of kissing up to you because you hold so much power. I'll look up that quote and I'll post it later.
Okay, thank you. All right, so let's move over to Federalist Paper 23. I think Hamilton's worth a discussion because he's an interesting character in our history. And, you know, very strong Federalist, obviously. He wrote many of these papers. And I'm just gonna say it. Sometimes I question his motives. This is just a candid discussion. You don't have to agree with me. Some people just love this guy. There's a musical about him. Okay, but he seemed in this particular paper to have given us a view into his real psyche. So, it kind of scared me, honestly. I'm surprised people even passed the Constitution after reading this. But so for instance, he's, you know, at the very beginning, stressing the importance of having a common defense, to be able to raise armies, to equip fleets. And yeah, that's important for a national defense, to prescribe rules for the government of both, to direct their operations, to provide for their support. And then he says this, these powers ought to exist without limitation. And I was like, ah, that sounds like the making of a dictatorship you know, military dictatorship. Like that seems like the perfect equation to that. Now, our Constitution has some stops on that. It didn't give him everything he wanted, it seems, because we haven't had that yet. But what were your thoughts on Hamilton, on this particular paper and what it claims and its effectiveness for maybe persuading the people to adopt it?
Well, I think for me, as soon as I see those words like power without limit, I have a visceral reaction. And I'm sure there were many at their time that did as well. So I immediately felt like that. But then I tried, I think it was Derek kind of said, you know, trying to see, or maybe it was you, Brooke, trying to see things as they did and think kind of the way they did in some respects. And I try to think about what Hamilton experienced. I mean, he was like behind the scenes of the war. He was in it, you know, he got to see what happened. He knew what it was like to have an army and not be able to get it the supplies it needed, to see men suffering as they were trying to defend this very noble cause, one that he felt incredibly invested and incredibly passionate about. And so, like, I was thinking about, you know, at Valley Forge, when, you know, what Washington was dealing with there and the men and what they were suffering, things like that. So I tried to at least put those unlimited power comments through that filter and see, okay, this is probably why, you know, he was so passionate about it. At the same time, I don't know that there's ever time for, I don't know that those words, unlimited power or power without limit, should ever be employed, but maybe I'm a little mistaken.
A thought that I have just in regard to Juliet's comment of trying to put it through the filter of Valley Forge and what this would have been like for Walton and the men that were out there and saying, we need supplies, we need reinforcements, we need all these different things. I think that whenever we consider war, this will sound really calloused, and I don't mean it this way. I think it's supposed to be messy. I think that's the way that it's supposed to go, which is why I'm glad that this didn't make it into our Constitution as it is, to where during times of war, you have unlimited power to do whatever it takes. Because it's only by considering the cost that you can really decide if it's worth the effort or worth the risk. And so for the executive, the president, you know, for that executive body to decide, do we go to war? They have to consider the cost. And I think of the arena in the Pacific. And the decision that was made to drop the two atomic bombs. And when they sat and they talked with MacArthur, he said, we can do it without it. We can still win, but it will cost us this many lives to do it. And they had to really weigh out those two things. And I think that war is supposed to be messy for that reason. Because if it wasn't, like people talk about autonomous warfare, drones and things like that. We take men out of war. That is an absolute recipe for chaos and disaster and destruction once you take the humanity, as much as that sucks for the moms and dads and spouses that have to get the visit, you have to have humanity in war to have humanity in general. Does that make sense? Like I said, I don't want that to sound really calloused and really insensitive, but I think it's an important thing to have to look at.
Does anyone want to comment to that?
And if that was a huge tangent, I apologize, but that's just... whenever we start talking about the military, that's always what I think about, is there's got to be a cost. There has to be. So
there does. Okay, Derek, did you have something?
Yeah, I have a feeling that, well, from what I understand, Hamilton was an officer in the army under Washington, right? He was one of his officers. And so he knows the blood of war. He knows the pains of war, the shrieks and cries of war, right? But here he is in the Constitutional Convention rubbing shoulders with giants. And maybe they didn't think of themselves at that time. They probably didn't know that they were going to have, well, I don't know. They said to ourselves and to our posterity at the end of the preamble for the Constitution. So they were looking for something not selfish. They didn't institute a king that would be implementing the means of their own destruction, because it was the monarchy that they defeated and didn't want to re-implement the same tyranny that they defeated. So I think that he was probably influenced making that kind of a comment. I'm just trying to dig into his psyche, like you were saying. I've got noble men around me. Noble men, the American people are never going to degenerate to the point to where they're not going to have noble men in charge. So why not limitless power, because we're going to do the right thing? Totally wrong, totally disagree. But the fact that that was in his head, to me, just speaks of, I can respectfully disagree. And I think that obviously he acquiesced because, you know, the Constitution was signed by him. I think that he just got used to being around noble men. That's my opinion. He was influenced by that.
Yeah, maybe we could give him the benefit of the doubt that, I mean, as John Adams said, this Constitution was only created to govern a moral and religious people and is wholly inadequate to the governance of any other. So would a moral or religious person enter into a military dictatorship and take over? But at the same time, you have Madison saying men are not angels, and if they were, we wouldn't need government. So it's hard to know. And that's why I said Hamilton is a questionable character to me. I just wonder about his motives, because I assume he knew these principles. He's a very intelligent person. And yet some of these things slip out where I'm like, and of course, he wanted a lot more nationalism or a lot more centralized government than this. He was really pushing for that central bank. And
right. Well, where was he from? He was from New York. He was from a big state. And so he was used to having a lot of power. And remember, he walked out of the Declaration of Independence, the meeting to become independent. He walked out and they had to go get him and bring him back. And each state had to have two signers for their state to count, and he was alone, so his signature wouldn't have counted for New York, but he asked permission at the end of the deliberation to become independent for the signing of the Declaration of Independence and received that permission. But when you see his name under New York, it's the only name, it's the sole name. So he was kind of a wild card. He's back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And now here we find him a chief author of one of the deliberation of the Constitution. So I see a progression in him. I don't know about you guys, seeing where he came from. He was a financial genius. If somebody's got some more information on that, I'm not super well-versed in his financial genius founding the nation's bank, or I don't want to speak on that because I'm not very familiar with that, but I just wanted to point that out.
You know, interestingly, I think our view and how horrifying that is to us is in thanks to the Constitution, which has now influenced all these countries. Look at Europe at the time. There was monarchies and, you know, the playing with pawns with all kinds of power, right? And so I think even our view of how bad that, you know, makes us feel is due in part to the work that these guys did, including him. And so I agree. And so I think I allow people to change their opinion over time as well, if that happened, right? And so I think these are, all of your thoughts have made me, kind of given me that idea of, wait, we see this world, we project ourselves back in time and say, well, I wouldn't have done that. And I'm not so sure. You know, sometimes our zeal exceeds our ability. I mean, I want to save everyone. I would make this right, you know? So it's kind of, we need to just be a little cautious on.
All right. Well, thank you for sharing, everybody. on these two papers. It was great discussion, and we'll reconvene later.